The Lost Civilization Enigma, a new inquiry into the existence of ancient cities, cultures, and peoples who predate recorded history, by Philip Coppens. Narrated by David Drummond. Copyright 2013 by Philip Coppens. This unabridged audiobook is published by arrangement with New Page Books, a division of Career Press, and was produced in the year 2012 by Tantor Media Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto. Introduction. Is history as the history books teach us? Or is civilization, when humanity began to cultivate plants, work metals, build monuments, and live in organized settlements, far more complex and older than we assume? As a 10-year-old child in school, my teacher taught that Greece was the cradle of civilization, even though in 1981 it was obvious that this was no longer the case. Egypt and Sumer were known to be far older civilizations, but somehow the textbooks used in Belgian schools had not caught up with facts. 30 years later, the situation has somewhat changed, but the criticism leveled at textbook historians remains. There reigns a paradigm that even though we no longer believe that God created the world in 4004 BC, we still assume that civilization could not possibly have existed previously. Before 4000 BC, it is widely assumed, our ancestors were pretty much savages. That is simply not the case. The latest archaeological findings have pushed the boundaries of civilization much further back to 10,000 BC, with sites such as Jericho and most recently Göbekli Tepe in Turkey. The existence of Jericho and Çatal Höyük has been known for decades and has been dated to 8,000 BC, but I challenge you to open your child's schoolbooks or any popular book on archaeology and find a reference to these cities in there. The few archaeological publications that do treat these sites as standalone pockets of civilization, even though they are all situated within hundreds of miles of each other. The obvious answer seems to be that they were part of one culture, but no such argument is explored by scientists. When it comes to truly lost civilizations, such as the lost civilization of Atlantis, historians even ridicule anyone considering making a scientific study of it. They argue that Plato created an idealized society rather than report a historical account, for the historians know there was no such civilization in existence in 10,000 BC. It simply cannot be. What they fail to report is that Plato wrote about Atlantis in a book solely devoted to history, and that when skeptics in his own time went to Egypt to discredit him, they instead returned with verification that Egyptian columns indeed contained the story of Atlantis, as Plato had reported. It shows, at the very least, that the ancient Egyptians believed in a lost civilization of Atlantis. In short, it shows that the theory cherished by historians is simply wrong. There is even evidence that signs of civilization, tools, objects, and legends are tens of thousands, even millions of years old. American author Michael Cremo cataloged hundreds of examples in a book he titled Forbidden Archaeology. It was his conclusion that such objects were deemed to be a no-go zone by archaeologists, as it would upset everything we have assumed to be true about our history. But that legends were factual was proven in the 19th century, when Heinrich Schliemann showed that Troy was not just a fable invented by the ancient Greeks, but a veritable city. The myths had proven to be true. In fact, there is good evidence that many of the reports of lost civilizations have always had a foundation in truth and reality. For many centuries, chroniclers doubted the existence of civilizations in the depths of the Amazon rainforest. But today, science is admitting its errors and acknowledges satellite imagery has revealed the traces of this lost civilization. Other claims of lost civilizations, such as Mu, remain outside of the reach of both archaeologists and explorers, but that doesn't mean they didn't exist. As the saying goes, the absence of available evidence doesn't mean it is evidence of its absence. Apart from slowly rediscovering lost civilizations, new dimensions of known civilizations are discovered on an almost daily basis. Yet each time the boundaries of civilization are pushed back or expanded, the messengers of this new information are attacked. When the enigmatic Antikythera device was discovered off the coasts of Greece in 1900, it took many decades before it was recognized as an astronomical clock, a device that was able to graphically show the position of the sun, moon, planets, and certain stars. Dating to ancient Greece, it is now heralded as the world's first computer, but most of the research into the device has been done by rebel archaeologists, who were often ferociously attacked by their colleagues for even considering this might be what it eventually turned out to be. Most recently, this antagonism to expanding the scope of ancient civilizations has been most apparent in the controversy surrounding the so-called Bosnian pyramids. The pyramid complex outside the town of Visoko, near the Bosnian capital of Sarajevo, would merely show that a civilization known as Old Europe, which blossomed between circa 5500 and 3000 BC, built pyramids. As Old Europe was in any other way on par with the Sumerian and Egyptian civilizations, why it would therefore not be able to build pyramids is strange. But since the discovery of these pyramids in 2005, science ferociously tries to maintain the existing paradigm, even threatening archaeologists not to partake in the excavations. Otherwise, they will never work at other archaeological sites ever again. The historical timeline, it seems, cannot be answered. Historians seem to cherish the dawn date of 4000 BC far dearer than the church ever did. There is also evidence that at least in Bronze Age Europe, circa 3000 BC, there was contact between America and Europe. Whereas we like to believe that it took the dawn of the 21st century for the first global civilization and economy, at least these two continents were very much working economically together 5,000 years ago. Our ancestors knew more than we give them credit for, and the Antikythera device is but one example of this. Florence and Kenneth Wood have identified a secret code that resides within Homer's Iliad and Odyssey. The Greek myths contain detailed stellar information, showing that the story has a layer that conveys quite advanced astronomical knowledge, including an understanding of the precession of the equinoxes, a discovery science is not willing to credit our ancestors with that far back. Most recently, analysis of the construction of Göbekli Tepe has shown that it incorporates astronomical concepts, for example, depictions of some constellations. This shows that our ancestors, 12,000 years ago, had already mapped the stars and were aware of at least the most basic concepts of astronomy, but likely much more. This latter conclusion can be reached when we realize that the cave paintings in Lascaux, France, date back 20,000 years and also incorporate astronomical knowledge. Lascaux is not a cave where our ancestors drew some scenes of their daily hunting lifestyle, but was a religious sanctuary containing the sacred knowledge of our times. The cave paintings have survived, but every other aspect of this civilization has disappeared, become lost to us. Our history is far more interesting, far older, and more impressive than the standard textbooks and history books present us. A Neolithic tomb at Boutier-Boulincourt, near Paris, contains the body of a man whose arm had been surgically and expertly amputated 5,900 years ago. Known civilizations, such as the Greeks, had objects that were able to visualize the orbits of the sun, the moon, and the planets. Known archaeological discoveries, like Jericho and Göbekli Tepe, show civilization is many thousands of years older than first thought. Adding lost civilizations, such as Atlantis, to this new image is merely another chapter in the story of civilization. In the New World, too, what the Spanish conquistadors found is far more complex and far more developed than we give the early inhabitants of America credit for. The resulting picture is that civilization as we know it is not 6,000 years old, but at least 12,000 years old, and that our ancestors, tens of thousands of years ago, were already crafting tools and objects, it is definitely obvious that our civilization is not the first. What was there before? What has been lost and is waiting to be rediscovered? Chapter 1. The New Inquisition. Many of us live with the idea that science is about expanding the horizons of our knowledge, boldly thinking where no one has thought before. However, in truth, that is rarely the case. There are very few Indiana Joneses out there. Science has expressed no interest at all in the Ark of the Covenant or crystal skulls, even though the first object was the center of the Jewish religion and the latter at the heart of the Mayan religion. Instead, scientists have labeled crystal skulls modern fabrications, while they show no interest at all in recovering lost objects like the Ark. When it comes to lost civilizations, all the evidence shows that science is dogmatic and is unwilling to even listen to the arguments presented in favor of their existence. Those who claim to have found evidence are accused of being unscientific, whether they are amateur or professional scientists, and are told the discovery simply cannot be, as science knows it is impossible. These days, science has no problem proclaiming they are all-knowing when it comes to these subjects. In the 1999 BBC documentary Atlantis Uncovered, Dr. Kenneth L. Fetter, a professor of archaeology at Central Connecticut State University, stated, "When we come to something like the lost continent of Atlantis, we are better off knowing that civilizations developed more or less independently, just so nobody can say some people are better than others, some are smarter than others, because we know what happens down the line when we believe that. So I'm not going to tell you that belief in Atlantis is necessarily the first step toward genocide or Holocaust, but what I'm telling you is we are on a very slippery slope if we believe in fantasies, and that those fantasies lead us down to places we really don't want to go." Fetter, in essence, argues that discussions about Atlantis, as well as discussions that civilizations traded and helped each other in their development, is a very slippery slope and a fantasy. And though he tells us not to immediately draw a comparison with genocide, he does draw that comparison. Seriously, Dr. Fetter? Science, it seems, is always more about preserving the status quo of what we already know than truly about expanding our boundaries of knowledge. Indeed, the evidence shows that the halls of academia are very much like the new Inquisition. They have not yet burned people at the stake, but they have thrown people in jail and destroyed the careers of those who tried to challenge the scientific dogma. The heretics are especially those who have tried to argue the case for the existence of lost civilizations or accidentally stumbled upon evidence that would upset the reigning paradigm. Such accidents often have had disastrous results for the innocent parties involved. Archaeological trench warfare. The excavations near the French village of Glozel, a hamlet located 10 miles from the French spa town of Vichy, are among the most controversial of archaeological endeavors ever recorded. These excavations lasted between 1924 and 1938, but the vast majority of finds, more than 3,000 artifacts, were unearthed in the first 2 years. The artifacts were variously dated to Neolithic, Iron Age, and medieval times. That in itself was not controversial. It is how one eventually arrived at these dates that reveals a saga of archaeological feuding and fraud versus truth. Glozel has been described as the Dreyfus affair of French archaeology, and the Dreyfus equivalent was Émile Fredin, a 17-year-old who, together with his grandfather Claude Fredin, stepped into history on March 1, 1924. Working in a farming field known as Duranton, Émile was holding the handles of a plow when one of the cows pulling it stuck its foot in a cavity. Freeing the cow, the Fredins uncovered a cavity containing human bones and ceramic fragments. So far, this could have been just any usual archaeological discovery, of which some are made every week. That soon changed. It is said that the first to arrive the following day to see what the farmers had unearthed were the neighbors. They not only found, but also took some of the objects. From there, the news spread around the village. That same month, Adrien Picandet, a local teacher, visited the Fredin's farm and decided to inform the Minister of Education. On July 9th, Benoit Clément, another teacher, this time from the neighboring village, and representing La Société d'Emulation du Bourbonnais, visited the site and later returned with a man called Viple. Clément and Viple used pickaxes to break down the remaining walls, which they took away with them. Some weeks later, Émile Fredin received a letter from Viple, in which the latter identified the site as dating from Gallo-Roman times, 1st to 4th centuries AD. He added that he felt that the site was of little interest. His advice was to recommence cultivation of the field, which is precisely what the Fredin family did. This might, therefore, have been the end of the saga, but not so. The January 1925 Bulletin de la Société d'Emulation du Bourbonnais reported on the findings. It brought the story to the attention of Antonin Morlaix, a Vichy physician and amateur archaeologist. Morlaix visited Clément and was intrigued by the findings. Morlaix was an amateur specialist in the Gallo-Roman period and believed that the objects from Glozel were older. He thought that some might even date from the Magdalenian period, 12,000 to 9,500 BC, which would make them extraordinarily old and one of the most important archaeological finds ever in France. Both Morlaix and Clément visited the farm and the field on April 26, 1925, and Morlaix offered the Fredins 200 francs per year to be allowed to complete the excavation. The family accepted. Morlaix began his excavations on May 24, 1925, discovering tablets, idols, bone and flint tools, and engraved stones. This material allowed him to identify the site as Neolithic. He published his Nouvelle Station Néolithique in September 1925, listing Émile Fredin as co-author. He argued that the site was, as the title of the article states, Neolithic in nature. Though Morlaix dated it as Neolithic, he was not blind to see that the site contained objects from various epochs. He still upheld his belief that some artifacts appeared to be older, belonging to the Magdalenian period, but added that the techniques that had been used appeared to be Neolithic. As such, he identified Glozel as a transition site between both eras, even though it was known that the two eras were separated by several millennia. Certain objects were indeed anachronistic. One stone showed a reindeer, accompanied by letters that appeared to be an alphabet. The reindeer vanished from that region around 10,000 BC, yet the earliest known form of writing at that time was believed to have been established around 3300 BC, and that was in the Middle East. The general consensus was that for the Glozel region, one would have to wait a further three millennia before writing was introduced. Worse, the script appeared to be comparable with the Phoenician alphabet, dated to circa 1000 BC, or to the Iberian script, which was derived from it. But, of course, it was known that no Phoenician colony could have been located in Glozel, so rather than explain the site, it made the site even harder to understand. But what Morlaix had shown was that rather than a site that seemed to have little or no importance, Glozel was a site that would upset the world of archaeology. Whereas he might have thought he was going to rewrite history and the story of how civilization evolved, it was, in truth, a time bomb, which would soon explode. When news of the discovery reached them, it should not come as a wonder that French archaeological academics were dismissive of Dr. Morlaix's report. After all, it was published by an amateur, a medical doctor, and a peasant boy, who perhaps could not even write properly. In their opinion, the amateurism dripped off their conclusion, for it challenged their carefully established and vociferously defended dogma on several levels. Prehistoric writing? A crossover between a Paleolithic and a Neolithic civilization? Nonsense. And hence, the halls of academia began to attack the conclusions Morlaix had reached, as they were simply impossible. One person claimed that the artifacts had to be fakes, as some of the tablets were discovered at a depth of 5 inches. Indeed, if that were the case, they would indeed be fakes. But the problem is that all the tablets were found at substantial depths. It is evidence of how the academics manipulated the facts, as the facts didn't fit the dogma. They were trying to explain Glozell away, rather than explain Glozell. It should be noted that the 5 inches argument continues to be used by several skeptics to this day, who falsely continue to assume it is true. Unfortunately for French academic circles, Morlaix was not one to lie down easily, and today his ghost continues to hang, if not watch, over Glozell. Morlaix invited a number of archaeologists to visit the site during 1926. They included Salomon Reynach, curator of the Musée d'Archéologie Nationale de Saint-Germain-en-Laye, who spent 3 days excavating. Reynach confirmed the authenticity of the site in a communication to the Académie des Inscriptions et Belles-Lettres. Even higher academic circles descended on the site. The famous archaeologist Abbé Breuil excavated with Morlaix and was impressed with the site. In late 1926, he wrote 2 articles in which Breuil stated that the authenticity of the Glozell site was incontestable. Breuil had also worked together with prehistorian André Vaison de Pradennes, who had visited the site under an assumed name and attempted to buy the artifacts from Pradennes. When Pradennes refused, Vaison de Pradennes became angry and threatened to destroy the site. Under his own name, he obtained permission to excavate from Dr. Morlaix, but then claimed to have detected Pradennes spreading salt in the excavation trench. Was Vaison de Pradennes keeping his promise that he would destroy the site? Morlaix chose to attack, and he challenged Vaison de Pradennes to duplicate what Pradennes had allegedly done. When he was unable to do so, or find where Pradennes had supposedly salted the trench, Morlaix felt he had successfully dealt with that impostor. He was wrong. Vaison de Pradennes' allegation made it into print, and the heat of the Glozell affair intensified, despite several leading scientists found in favor of its authenticity. At first, Breuil tried to remain neutral, but it would be a reindeer that soured the relationship between Breuil and Morlaix, as Breuil had identified an engraved animal on a tablet as a cervid, neither reindeer nor elk. Morlaix, however, had received confirmation from Professor August Brinkmann, director of the zoology department at Bergen Museum, Norway, and informed Breuil of his mistake. It was the moment when Breuil changed his attitude in the Glozell debate. But rather than talk, which is what his attackers were doing, Morlaix dug, unearthing throughout a period of 2 years 3,000 objects, all of varied forms and shape, including 100 tablets carrying signs and approximately 15 tablets carrying the imprints of human hands. Other discoveries included 2 tombs, sexual idols, polished stones, dressed stones, ceramics, glass, bones, and so on. Surely these could not be fakes, as archaeologists were saying. Who would make thousands of artifacts? His attackers were straightforward in naming their suspect, Pradennes. Breuil was more open-minded than his colleagues, but it is apparent that he did not like to be proven wrong in the case of his cervid. So, rather than admit his mistake, instead, he drifted further and further in the ranks of those intent on discrediting Glozell, for no other reason than if Morlaix's findings were true, the site would be thousands of years older than they thought it could be, and, more importantly, than they had said in print. On August 2, 1927, Breuil reiterated that he wanted to stay away from the site. On October 2, he wrote that everything is false except the stoneware pottery. Just before that, at the meeting of the International Institute of Anthropology in Amsterdam, held in September 1927, the Glozell site was the subject of heated controversy, so much so that a commission was appointed to conduct further investigation. Its membership was largely comprised of people who had already decided the Glozell finds were fraudulent. Among the group was British archaeologist Dorothy Garrod, who had studied with Broglie. The commissioners arrived at Glozel on November 5, 1927. During their excavations, several members found artifacts. But on the third day, Morlaix saw commission members Dorothy Garrod, Abbé Favre, and Mr. Emile Landrin slip under the barbed wire and set off toward the open trench before he had opened the gate of the excavation site. Morlaix followed Garrod and saw that she stuck one of her fingers into the plaster pattern on the side of the trench, making a hole. He shouted out, reprimanding her for what she had just done. Caught in the act, she at first denied it. But in the presence of her two colleagues, as well as the attorney, Malat, and a scientific journalist, Tricot Royer, she had to admit she had made the hole. This was clearly a smoking gun. A leading archaeologist had been caught trying to falsify an archaeological excavation. But what happened? It was agreed they would not speak about the incident, showing the gracious nature of all men involved toward Miss Garrow. However, Morlaix did speak about it after the commission had published its unfavorable report. This might be seen as mudslinging, trying to get back at the commission, but unfortunately for those willing to adhere to this theory, a photograph exists that attests to the incident having occurred. In it, Garrod is hiding behind the four men, who are in heated discussion about what she had just done. Most importantly, Tricot Royer and Malat also gave written testimony confirming Morlaix's account. What was Garrod trying to do? Some have claimed it was merely an accident, but it is remarkable that she was part of a posse that entered the site, in essence they broke in, before the official start of the day and had an accident that could have been interpreted as evidence of someone interfering with the excavation. If others had found that the excavation had been tampered with, fingers would not have been pointed at Garrod, but instead at Fredin, whom the archaeologists suspected of being the forger, burying artifacts in the ground, only to have amateur archaeologists like Morlaix, who did not know better, discover them. If this suggestion, that Fredin had entered the site at night, had been made, it would have resulted in a case closed, and the Glozel artifacts would have been qualified as fraudulent. Fortunately, Garrod and company were caught in the act. However, the incident did not cause any harm to Dorothy Garrod's career. She went on to teach a generation of British archaeologists at Cambridge. Perhaps unremarkably, she made sure to tell all of them that the Glozel artifacts were fakes, and several of her students echoed her informed opinion. The list included Glyn Daniel and Colin Renfrew, both fervent critics of the Glozel finds. We can only wonder whether the finger incident is known to these modern pillars of archaeology. Decades later, when the skeptical archaeologists were challenged with evidence that thermoluminescence and carbon dating had shown that the Glozel artifacts could not be forgeries created by Fredin, Renfrew wrote in 1975, "The three papers, taken together, suggest strongly that the pottery and terracotta objects from Glozel, including the inscribed tablets, should be regarded as genuine, and with them, presumably, the remainder of the material. I still find it beyond my powers of imagination to take Glozel entirely seriously." So let us get this right. Though all the archaeological evidence suggested the site was genuine, Renfrew's emotions, and especially his powers of imagination, prevented him from taking it seriously. That is, of course, not science, but simply evidence of the fact that Renfrew is a bad scientist. He cannot accept hard scientific facts. It is precisely this attitude that has prevented archaeologists from addressing the issue of lost civilizations. But back to the past. Morlaix sent a letter to Mercure de France, published on November 15, 1927, still upset with Broglie's qualification of the site as a fake and having spotted one of his students sticking an unwanted finger into an archaeological trench. "From the time your article appeared, I declared to anyone who wanted to listen, especially to your friends, so that you would hear about it, that I would not allow you to present a site already studied at length as a discovery which had not been described before you wrote about it. I know that in a note you quoted the title of our articles, that you thank me for having led you to Glozell, and that finally you give your thanks to our kindness in having allowed you to examine our collections. You acknowledge that I am a good chauffeur. I have perceived a little that I have also been a dupe. Your report on Glozell is conceived as if you were the first to study the site, so much so that several foreign scholars are misinformed about it. Your first master, Dr. Capitain, suggested to me forthrightly that we republish our leaflet with the engravings at the end and his name before mine. With you, the system has evolved. You take no more than the ideas. Morlaix was highlighting one of the main goals of the archaeologists, to have their name on top of a report and be identified as the discoverer of Glozell. It is standard practice in science, in which amateurs specifically are supposed to stand aside and let the professionals deal with it, and thus take the credit for the discovery. Again, Morlaix did not want to have any of it. The Archaeological Commission's report of December 1927 declared that everything found at the Glozell site, with the exception of a few pieces of flint axes and stoneware, was fake. It meant that the accepted view of history remained standing, for nothing at Glozell was genuine. Still, members of the commission, such as Professor Mendes Cora, argued that the conclusions were incorrect and misrepresentative. In fact, he argued that the results of his analyses, when completed, would be the opposite of what had been claimed by Count Begouin, the principal author of the report. Indeed, Begouin later had to confess that he had made up an alleged dispatch from Mendes Cora. So the first evidence of fraud came from the likes of Garrett and Begouin, not Fredin. It shows the power of science and how it is able to mold opinions, for a century later, the standard line is that Garrett and Begouin are pillars of science and Fredin a fraud. The need to condemn Glozell is further illustrated by René Dussault, curator at the Louvre and a famous epigrapher. Dussault had written a dissertation that argued that our alphabet is of Phoenician origin. If Morlaix was correct, Dussault's life work would be discredited. Dussault made sure that would not happen, and thus he told everyone that Fredin was a forger, and even sent an anonymous letter about Fredin to one of the Parisian newspapers. When similar finds to those at Glozell were unearthed in Alvo in Portugal, Dussault stated that they, too, had to be fraudulent, even though the artifacts were discovered beneath a dolmen, leaving little doubt that they were of Neolithic origin. When similar artifacts were found in the immediate vicinity of Glozell, at two sites at Chez Guerrier and Puy Ravel, Dussault wrote, "If, as they claim, the stones discovered in the Mercier field and in the cave of Puy Ravel bear the writing of Glozell, there can be no doubt the engravings on the stones are false." Deny, 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 for otherwise it would show Dussault's thesis was wrong. Faced with such attacks, what could a little-educated farmer like Fredin do? In a move that seems to have been a few decades ahead of his time, on January 10, 1928, Fredin filed suit for defamation against Dussault. Indeed, a peasant boy of 20 was suing the curator of the Louvre for defamation. Dussault had no intention of appearing in court and must have realized that if he did, he could lose the case. He needed help, fast, for the first hearing was set for February 28, 1928, and Fredin had already received the free assistance of a lawyer who was greatly intrigued by a case of peasant boy versus Louvre curator. Dussault therefore engineered the help of the president of the Société Préhistorique Française, Dr. Félix Regnault, who visited Glozell on February 24, 1928, and after the briefest of visits to the small museum, filed a complaint against X, as if Regnault did not know who was operating the museum. That the entire incident was engineered is obvious, As Regnault had come with his attorney, Maurice Garcon, who immediately traveled from Glozel to Moulins to file the complaint. The accusation was that the admission charge of 4 francs was excessive to see objects which, in his opinion, were fakes. The police, of course, quickly identified X as Émile Fradin. The next day, the police searched the museum, destroyed glass display cases, and confiscated 3 cases of artifacts. Émile was beaten when he protested against the taking of his little brother's school books as evidence. Saucepans filled with dirt by his little brother were assumed to be artifacts in the making. But despite all of this, the raid produced no evidence whatsoever of forgery. However, Dussault had played this card to perfection. Fredin's suit for defamation could not proceed because a criminal investigation was underway. It meant that the defamation hearing set for February 28, 1928, would not happen for as long as the criminal investigation continued. Dussault, it seemed, had won. Meanwhile, a new group of neutral archaeologists, the Committee of Studies, was appointed by scholars who, since the November conference in Amsterdam, and specifically since the report's publication in December, were uncomfortable with how the archaeological world was handling Glozel. They excavated from April 12th to 14th, 1928, and continued to find more artifacts. Their report spoke out for the authenticity of the site, which they identified as Neolithic. It seemed that Morlaix had been vindicated. Meanwhile, the excavations and controversies surrounding Glozel made it a destination for tourists. This so enraged the archaeologists that they organized a raid on the museum, destroying most of the display cabinets and injuring some of Fredin's family members. Any vindication was soon outdone when Gaston Edmond Bail, chief of the Criminal Records Office in Paris, analyzed the artifacts seized in the raid, and in May 1929 identified them as recent forgeries. Originally, Bail had said that it would take only 8 or 9 days to prepare a report, but a year passed without anything being set down on paper. This, of course, was excellent news for Dussault, as it delayed his defamation hearing. To pave the way for the report's release, on October 5, 1928, information was leaked to the papers, who played their part by faithfully stating that the report would conclude that the Glozel artifacts were forgeries. In May 1929, Bail completed a 500-page report, just in time to postpone once again the Dussault case, which was scheduled for hearing on June 5, 1929. Bail argued that he could detect fragments of what might have been grass and an apple stem in some of the Glozel clay tablets. As grass obviously could not have been preserved for thousands of years, it was obviously a recent forgery, he reasoned. The argument is very unconvincing, for the excavations were obviously not handled as a forensic crime scene would be treated. Most likely, the vast majority of these artifacts were placed on grass or elsewhere after they were dug up from the pit, a practice that continues on most of today's archaeological excavations. Archaeology at this level was and is not a forensic science. Later, it would even emerge that some of the objects had also been placed in an oven to dry them, which would later interfere with carbon dating efforts on the artifacts. But that heating up an artifact in an oven would one day interfere with dating the artifact was unknown in the 1920s, when carbon dating didn't even exist. Bizarrely, in September 1930, Bail was assassinated in an unrelated event, but not unfamiliar charges. His assassin accused him of having made a fraudulent report that had placed him in jail. After his death, it was found that Bail had lived an extravagant lifestyle that was inconsistent with his salary. Most damagingly, Bail was close to Vaison de Pradin, who was the son-in-law of his former superior at the Criminal Records Office. It seems the Breuil-Vaison de Pradin-Dussault axis was not only powerful in archaeological circles, it could also dictate to the wheels of the law. The court accepted Bail's findings, and on June 4, 1929, Fredin was formally indicted for fraud. For the following few months, Fredin was interrogated every week in Moulins. Eventually, the verdict was overturned by an appeal court in April 1931. For 3 years, Dussault had been able to terrorize Fredin for his insolence in filing a suit against him. Unfortunately, though the wheels of the law had largely played to the advantage of the axis of archaeology, in the final analysis, righteousness had won. The defamation charge against Dussault came to trial in March 1932, and Dussault was found guilty of defamation, with all costs of the trial to be paid by him. But 8 years after the first discovery, the leading archaeologists continued to claim that the Glozel artifacts were fraudulent, though all the evidence, including a lengthy legal cause, had shown that was absolutely not the case. But why bother with facts when there are pet theories and reputations to be defended? Morlaix ended his excavations in 1938, and after 1942, a new law outlawed private excavations. A perfect law, of course, for archaeologists, who ever since have been solely in charge of excavation sites and can therefore conclude whatever they want without any oversight or external verification. Indeed, the law has given archaeologists free rein in the clearly wrong assumption that all they are after is the truth. Meanwhile, the Glozel site remained untouched until the Ministry of Culture reopened excavations in 1983. A full report was never published, but a 13-page summary did appear in 1995. This official report infuriated many, for the authors suggested that the site was medieval, possibly containing some Iron Age objects, but was likely to have been enriched by forgeries. It therefore reinforced the earlier position of the leading French archaeologists. But on June 16, 1990, Émile Fredin received the Ordre des Palmes Académiques, suggesting that the French academic circles had accepted him for making a legitimate discovery and that he was not a forger. The Glozel excavation site, however, continues to be seen as a giant hoax. Émile Fredin was equally honored that the British Museum requested some of his artifacts to go on display in 1990 in this holy of holies of archaeology. What he did not know, because of a language barrier, was that the exhibit was highlighting some of the greatest archaeological hoaxes and forgeries in history. What Glozel teaches us is that when amateur archaeologists make extraordinary discoveries, they better wet their chests, for the halls of academia will do everything to take over, and if unsuccessful, to mock the findings, going to any lengths necessary to protect their reputation. And the final verdict is that despite no evidence whatsoever of fraud, but with evidence that the archaeologists were committing fraud and defamation, science continues to see Glozel as a hoax. In the final analysis, Glozel is unlikely to have been evidence of a lost civilization, but when it was discovered, it was believed to have been evidence that would completely rewrite the history books and push back the discovery of writing many thousands of years. It could still be, if only archaeologists would revisit the case with open minds and retest the artifacts involved. Confirming Chinese pyramids. Though pyramids are large, and the Great Pyramid just outside of Egypt's capital Cairo is very large, they dwarf in comparison to the Great Wall of China, humanity's largest building project so far. The wall stretches over a formidable 6,352 kilometers, 3,948 miles. If it were reassembled at the equator, it would girdle the globe with a wall 8 feet high and 3 feet thick. Despite the controversy whether or not we can see the Great Wall from space, apparently you can't, in 1920, in The Travels of Marco Polo, historian Henri Cordier wrote, "China's ancient past is denied both to us and its population. Its grand past is slowly unveiled, similar to how Egypt's was revealed. Later on, one learned of buildings, standing stones, and other monuments that were not mentioned by the Chinese historians as part of their history." the largest country in the world, was and is still largely there to be discovered. And for a period of time, the people of China were presented a history of their country that was known not to be true. China, of course, is not unique in this, but it will be the example we use. Though accepted as a great civilization, its ancient treasures were barely known to the Western world a century ago, and in the vast rural areas of China, much remains to be explored. Turn back the clock a few decades, and we were confronted with rumors of pyramids in China. 20 years ago, there was no real proof, outside of China, that these pyramids were real. Now, less than 2 decades later, everyone can visit them, showing how quickly paradigms can change if we allow them to change. The Chinese pyramids were largely only known through travelers' accounts of their voyages through that country. In 1912, Fred Meyer Schroeder and Oscar Mammon traveled to Shinsi in the province of Xi'an. They dealt in tobacco and candles, but also supplied the Mongolians with weapons. Their guide along the Chinese-Mongolian border was a monk, Bogdo, the Holy One, who told them they would soon stumble upon some ancient pyramids. Though he himself had never seen them, he knew some could be found around the old town of Xianfu, Xi'an. Bogdo knew that 7 pyramids had been discovered. When he finally saw them, Schroeder estimated that the tallest structure measured 300 meters high and its sides 500 meters long. This would mean that this pyramid was the largest in the world, twice as large as the Great Pyramid of Egypt. The volume was 20 times as large as the Great Pyramid. Though we should expect that the people who built the Great Wall would be able to build the greatest pyramid, history was about to be rewritten. Schroeder noted that it was aligned north-south-east-west, like the Great Pyramid, continuing that, in the past, they were apparently partly covered with stones, but those have disappeared. A few stones lie at the bottom. It is an earthen pyramid with giant gullies on its sides. They were the reason why the stones loosened and fell down. Its sides are now partially covered with trees and shrubs. It almost looks like a natural hill. We rode around the pyramid, but did not discover any stairways or doors. When questioned about its age, Bogdo believed that it was at least 5,000 years old, and therefore as old or older than the Great Pyramid. He stated that Chinese ancient records claimed that even then, the pyramids were deemed to be old, and thus seemed to predate anything that we knew about Chinese history. Evidence of a lost civilization? Schroeder's account of the pyramids is detailed, but was not the first. In 1908, Arthur de Carl Sowerby and Robert Sterling Clark saw the pyramids during their expedition and wrote about them in their 1912 account, Through Shenkan. The visitor to Xi'an, as he travels over the rolling plain from no matter what direction, cannot fail to notice numerous mounds of unusual shape dotted about everywhere like immense molehills, often attaining a height of at least 100 feet, and standing on bases of very considerable area. So remarkable are they that he will instinctively seek information concerning them, and will learn that they are the tombs of kings and emperors and their wives, and of scholars and sages notable in their day. But few indeed have anything in the way of tombstone or epitaph to tell who sleeps beneath the tones of yellow earth, though concerning some, fantastic legends still linger in the minds of the people. A third early report originated from the Ségalen mission, a tour of China that French doctor, ethnographer, archaeologist, writer, and poet Victor Ségalen made in 1909 to 1914 and 1917. In 1913, he measured the pyramid's height at 48 meters, encompassing 5 terraces. One side measured 350 meters in length, a stunning 120 meters longer than the side of the Great Pyramid at Giza. The Ségalen mission also revealed the existence of more pyramids and tombs along the River Wei, the largest tributary of the Yellow River that flows past Xi'an. He also dated the structures to the Han period, following that of Emperor Qin Shi Huang, 259 to 210 BC, the man who had built the first Great Wall, bringing the entire story into the folds of known Chinese history. But though the pyramids were no longer evidence of a lost civilization, they were clearly adding a great dimension to a known civilization. The Cold War largely placed China off limits to Western visitors. Throughout these turbulent decades, the stories of the early explorers and their reports of pyramids in China fed the imagination of Western pyramidophiles. New Zealand author Bruce Cathy became interested in the Chinese pyramids and wrote on the subject in The Bridge to Infinity, published in 1983. Cathy reported that a member of the Chinese embassy had officially informed him there were no such things as pyramids in the Shaanxi province. There are a few tumuli, burial hills, but no pyramids. Cathy saw this as a straightforward denial of the Chinese that no such structures existed. The Chinese quickly clarified their statement. A letter from Chinese authorities, dated November 1, 1978, addressed to Cathy, stated that the scientists had learned that the so-called pyramids were burial tombs of emperors of the Western Han Dynasty. Records give a different version of the emperors' lives. As the graves have not been scientifically analyzed and no markings were seen on the ground, it is difficult to formulate conclusions. So there were pyramids, but these were tombs, not pyramids, though they were pyramidal in shape. Confused? Rules and regulations for travelers were somewhat eased following the death of Chairman Mao Zedong in 1976, but real change was slow. American historical travel writer David Hatcher Childress wrote about Chinese pyramids in 1985, but was unable to visit them. The major breakthrough came only in 1994, after the collapse of the Iron Curtain, when German tour operator Hartwig Hausdorff was allowed to enter former no-go areas and came away with fresh knowledge of the Chinese pyramids. So, in 1994, Hartwig Hausdorff and his company of fellow travelers landed at the new Xi'an Airport, near the neighboring town of Xianyang, and, driving to the city in their hotel, saw one pyramid that stood along the road. It had been discovered a few years earlier when Xi'an's airport was relocated and a road to the city was built. In 1995, he told me, "It's a small miracle I received the go-ahead to enter some no-go areas. I was, in fact, the only one who was granted such favors. I assume there are two reasons for this. I regularly visit China with a group of tourists. In 1993, I became acquainted with Chen Jianni, an avid researcher of his country's past. He assured me that he would try and open a few doors inside the Chinese Ministry of Tourism. In fact, in March 1994, I was able to visit some former no-go areas in the Shaanxi province. I passed around some copies of my German book, Die Weiße Pyramide, The White Pyramid, to the right people. I talked to archaeologists who at first denied any pyramids existed, but finally recognized that they did exist. I was most pleased when the same people gave me further permission to enter other no-go zones when I returned in October 1994. I never expected any of this would happen to me. But it seems it had to happen eventually. Following decades of rumor, someone had to clear the picture." And thus it was a tour operator and amateur archaeologist, not a professional archaeologist, who confirmed the existence of Chinese pyramids. In March 1994, Hausdorff climbed a pyramid and saw a few more from its top. In October 1994, he climbed the same pyramid again and was able to count 20 more pyramids, all in the immediate vicinity. It confirmed what had been seen from a U.S. Air Force map of the area around the city of Xi'an, made with the use of satellite photographs, which showed at least 16 pyramids. But old Chinese, or is that scientific, habits died hard, it seemed. In March 1994, Hausdorff also met Professor Feng Haozhang, a prominent member of Beijing's academic circle, his assistant, Xie Duanyu, and three colleagues. At first, they denied the existence of the pyramids, But when Hausdorff showed them three photos of three different pyramids, they caved. Hausdorff described this encounter. "It was as if I had entered a hive." The photographs I took in both March and October 1994 are the proof that squelched 5 decades of rumor. Most scientists denied the existence of pyramids in China. If any scientist still clings to that, show him my photographs. Less than 2 decades later, anyone traveling to Xi'an will come face to face with the pyramids and is free to explore them. What was once denied, the subject of rumor and speculation, is now in plain view and accepted by all. But even though we know of the pyramids' existence, we know little else about them. They have still not been excavated by Chinese archaeologists. One of the pyramids, burial mounds, is that of Emperor Qin Shi Huang himself, the man who built the first Great Wall, the first emperor, but also the man of the famous so-called Terracotta Army, which is one of the main tourist attractions in Xi'an. His pyramid sits just 1 mile from where the army was buried. It is believed that Qin Shi Huang's mausoleum once stood almost 330 feet in height, though today it measures to just 150 feet. Its sides measure between 1,600 and 1,700 feet, giving the structure a volume that also exceeds that of the Great Pyramid. One story goes that automatic crossbows and arrows designed to fire are installed inside if the tomb is entered. It may seem a tall claim, but it could be true. In Records of the Historian, Biography of Qin Shi Huang, Han historian Sima Chen describes the automatic crossbows and a burial chamber containing miniature palaces and pavilions with flowing rivers and surging oceans of mercury lying beneath a ceiling decorated in jewels depicting the sun, moon, and stars. There could be truth in the latter statement, as the ceilings in some of the excavated satellite tombs did indeed contain depictions of stars. Recent scientific work at the site has also shown high levels of mercury in the soil of Mount Li, tentatively indicating that Sima Chen may have provided an accurate description of the contents of the pyramids. A magnetic scan of the site has also revealed that a large number of coins are lying in the unopened tomb. A preliminary month-long excavation was done in 1986 and revealed extensive damage, probably by Tang and Song robbers, which has led some archaeologists to conclude that the interior structure, despite Sima Chen's wonderful description, may be found largely void. As it turns out, Emperor Qin Shi Huang was greatly intrigued by mythology and lost civilizations. He died while on a tour to eastern China, searching for the legendary Islands of the Immortals off the coast of eastern China, and for the secret of eternal life, which he did not find. Reportedly, he died of swallowing mercury pills, which were made by his court scientists and doctors, but which erroneously contained too much mercury. Equally ironic was that these pills were thought to make him immortal. Qin Shi Huang was buried in his mausoleum, together with the famous Terracotta Army nearby. That famous Terracotta Army of China is one of the greatest archaeological findings in recent history.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.